desk filled with misery and pain. No, I'm just kidding. Kibler's here. He is never miserable and in pain.
Rarely.
Yeah, very rarely. Yeah.
But anyway, we won't talk about that.
We have, it happened once, but we won't talk about that. Anyway, we have a great matchup lined up for you. It is going to be Just Saiyan, my pick that is remaining on the board, versus Hot Meowth. And Just Saiyan is a name that you probably know a decent amount about. Hot Meowth, probably a little bit less. The one thing that stands out to me about Hot Meowth is that he recently took rank 1 legend using an aggro shaman playing Maelstrom Portal, which is in fact the list that he's brought to this tournament.
I actually mostly just like his name. Yeah. I think it's great.
thanks for the analysis, Ryan.
I mean, Just Saiyan also has an excellent name.
Yes.
It's a very good pun. You know, not really a pun, sort of play on words, I suppose, but it's just sort of a pun.
Thanks, bro.
You're welcome. Yeah.
But yeah, Just Saiyan was my pick. And the reasons Frodan gave were kind of very succinct as to how I put it. It's like he's kind of famous for these streams where with his practice groups, he goes through and he evaluates metas and evaluates new cards as they're released. And I really kind of connect with his ideology. I don't necessarily like agree with his output all the time, but I like the way he approaches the game in terms of his use of statistics and spreadsheets, etc., to try and find an advantage. So I think that's becoming a bigger and bigger thing in Hearthstone overall. Was that people are trying to find that advantage using the power of mathematics, if you like.
Yeah, in a lot of cases, you know, players will have sort of a feel for matchup, and that's also important when you're testing, figure out not only, okay, which deck is winning, but, well, why is it winning? What does the games look like where it wins? What do the games look like when it loses? Mm-hmm. But a lot of times, you know, players, for instance, will really like playing, say, a control deck, because when you're winning for a long time.
Yeah.
So it's like, ooh, this feels great. I'm in control. I'm just crushing this person. But math can help show that those are not necessarily the majority of your games, mm-hmm. even though it feels like it, because they take a long time when you win.
So people have really narrowed it down to the point now where, you know, you're evaluating the particular win rate of a particular card mm-hmm. played on a particular turn. So it's like, oh, if I play a Wrathy Weaponsmith on turn 4, this is how often I win the game. And like that kind of stuff seems like finicky and tryhardy, but if you get enough of that data and pile it all together, then you start approaching the situation where you're almost solving the format and mm-hmm. working out what the optimal decks are. And I think as the game gets older and older, that's a position that we move further and further towards.
I mean, we've seen, you know, all kinds of competitive endeavors take to data analysis, and you know, it's not surprise me that Hearthstone's one of them.
Yes, but all things aside, we are going to see our opening matchup just be Shaman versus Shaman. Both of these players favoring the aggro list, pretty much the standard. Very little flex in this list these days. Everyone's pretty much refined this point down to a science.
And a lot of the data analysis in this particular game is, what are you at? Yeah. Oh, I got that much. Ugh, face.
Yeah. The complex level of maths here is, how much damage do I have in my hand? What is the number on your hero? These two numbers line up quite nicely.
Although, to be fair, a lot of people will sort of disparage aggressive decks. Oh, they don't take it. You know, they don't take skill or reasoning or whatever.
Sure.
But there are actually lots of small decisions, like the placement of your minions,
yes.
specifically your mulligan decisions. Mm-hmm. What's important to mulligan in any given matchup, and the sequencing with which you use your removal effects or damage effects against particular decks. Mm-hmm. So there's actually a lot of going on, though it may seem like it's just 7/7 for 4 attacking your opponent's face.
Well, yeah, very much so. And I think, you know, I said there's very little play in this, but as I mentioned at the start, Hot Meowth is, of course, running that single copy of Maelstrom Portal, which can be devastating. It's a card that makes a little bit of sense to me in the deck, because most of your early game is kind of low attack, high health minions, despite being an aggro deck. You know, most aggro decks are loading their stats towards the front end quite often and just trying to deal damage, whereas Shaman just has all these sticky creatures. So if you just have a bunch of 1/3s and 2/3s on the board and your opponent just kind of has the same, then Maelstrom Portal is a very effective card at being able to break that tie.
Absolutely. It's also works very well with Flame Tongue Totem, gives you additional body that you can use alongside that. And it also helps shore up some of the matchups like Zoo, where you can often fall behind, and you can often fall behind early and not be able to catch up, when something like Lightning Storm won't necessarily, it can give you a way to get back into the game, but it can't necessarily give you the opportunity to be in a game that you you otherwise were far behind on early on. But Saiyan does find the second abusive sergeant.
Huge
speaking of falling behind early on, allows him to take out the Totem Golem. But Hot Meowth finds an abusive sergeant, which is an excellent, or rather a Argent Squire, which is the next answer to those abusive sergeants.
Yeah, Just Saying absolutely whiffs on this turn. Healing Totem, not what he'd have been looking for. Taunt Totem would have been the optimal outcome there for him, but he has been able to just seize control of the board at least for a turn, and that might just be enough initiative to allow him to drop that Flame Wreath Faceless on curve now and just have the threat of that 7-7 either pushing damage or just controlling the board, whatever the state of the game dictates.
Yeah, Hotmouth takes his obvious decision of clearing one of the sergeants with his squire. Now debating exactly how he wants to use his mana right now. He could use the Rockbiter to clear this and use his hero power, which would open up the possibility of Thing from Below next turn. Does choose to just take out the totem with the Horse Rider. Mm. Interestingly, killed the totem. Playing around the possibility of Flame Tongue here?
Right, I mean, as much as these are two aggressive decks, this mirror matchup is one very much for the fight for the early game board. So if you want to boil it down just purely to what is the value trade for my Horse Rider here, it is just taking out that totem because it's the one thing you can do without even losing your shield. So in terms of maximizing the potential of just individual bodies that 2-1 gets to take out as the Maelstrom Portal is drawn.
And that lines up beautifully. Portal can clear the abusive sergeant and then the Rockbiter plus the two minions on board can finish off the 7-7. This is actually a perfect portal right here. Finds him not necessarily the perfect minion, but if he draws Sir Finley, he's got himself a 2-2.
Oh, the plays.
Gotta find, you know, the upside and everything. That's what I'm around for.
That's what I'm saying. The eternal optimist, Brian Kibler. But yeah, I mean, we can mock the fact that, like, sure, he got a 1-2 minion off this, right?
It's a
but,
body.
Like, it's a body.
Yeah, and that's very relevant.
Arcane Explosion is already a card in this game that exists, right? And it's a card that mages have been playing to an extent. You know, some lists that I've seen on ladder play it to counteract Zoo specifically. And tempo removal as a theme in Hearthstone is a very, very powerful tool that is used very sparingly in the card design. And we've seen two of them printed in this set with
Firelands Portal and Firelands Portal.
So it's interesting that more of those cards are being added to the game. It's also a little bit sad that Priest didn't get any of it, which would have been a little bit nice.
Well, they already have Forbidden Shaping, which is another summon a random minion thing. But what they needed.
Yeah. I feel like a little bit of tempo removal might not go amiss for Priest, personally.
Especially if it costs 3.
Yeah, sure. but back in this game, that Maelstrom Portal has kind of just secured the board for him here, and this is a decision that a lot of people probably wouldn't have made. A lot of people get very tunnel visioned on that Doomhammer on turn 5 if it's available, but
I can hit things.
Right. But in this matchup specifically, or in aggro versus aggro matchups, you kind of want to Doomhammer behind an existing board. You want to have board dominance and then Doomhammer behind it. So dropping the 5-5 here gave him the best chance of being able to do that.
This also opens up this exact play this turn, which is Doomhammer plus Lightning Bolt, killing the Thing from Below and allowing you to just keep going face with your own thing. Whereas if he played his Doomhammer last turn, he wouldn't have had the mana available this turn to necessarily develop his own thing and do anything else. Yep. So it's going to be a great turn here for Hotmeowth as he's able to clear off Saiyan's entire board and get some face damages. He is down to just 19, but he's the one with Doomhammer and a board presence already.
Yeah. I can feel it every time, by the way, just how much you enjoy saying Hot Meowth.
Name is great.
It is fantastic. Tuskar Totemic comes down, does pick up the Mana Tide. Hot Meowth gives the customary roll of the eyes, which I believe
we've seen a lot
is
of that.
Mandatory.
We've seen that on both sides of the board. You know, when the perfect turn for Hot Meowth came down, say I gave a little bit of a roll of the eyes, then that comes down, a little bit of a roll of the eyes. So
I think it's actually in the contract that you sign to compete in an HCT event that you do have to roll your eyes whenever Tuskar Totemic produces a favorable outcome for your opponent.
All right, well, Lightning Storm gets a favorable outcome here, clears off the 3 health totem, and Hot Meowth just keeps getting that hammer into the face of Just Saiyan.
Right.
There's Sir Finley on the wrong side, couldn't power up that Murloc Tidecaller, but who has sadly been long gone.
Yeah, and this is all just coming a little bit too late now for Saiyan. He really needed to pick up a Doomhammer earlier when he had some of his life to play with so that he could have taken down that 5-5 alongside the Rockbiter. But
all right, well, speaking of eye rolls, let's see what comes off this Lightning Storm.
Sure.
He really needs a 3 on the... Oh.
No.
He did not. And we see that. This is a study in highs and lows here.
Yes.
We see the fist bump and you know, release of the exasperated air from each player. So Saiyan can kill the Thing from Below, does have to take 5 damage to do so, and is still facing the Doomhammer plus Tunnel Trog, so definitely a tough spot for the Tempo Storm player.
Yeah, he can also Finley first here. If he picks up Mage Hero Power, then he has the decision where he can choose to ping off the 3-1 instead. If he doesn't have a Hero Power that he wants to use, which none of these really look like, then he can still afford to bail out with the Rockfire weapon and the thing from below of his own. Which is, looks like exactly what's going to happen. This 5 to face is not pretty, but he is at least, for one turn only, a fraction in control of the board. Because after this 3-1 and Doomhammer takes out the 5-5 and the 0-2, he is still a 1-3 ahead of the board, but Hot Meow picks up some gas, so that advantage does not last very long. Yeah,
Feral Surge is particularly strong given that he also has the Flame Tongue. He's likely to play this turn, or maybe not play this turn since he actually is able to just power up the Tunnel Trog. Yeah, I think he's going to play it. Okay, chooses not to give Just Saiyan any opportunity to make inroads and keep his Sir Finley alive.
Yeah, the choice of the Flame Tongue being committed to the board here is interesting because you do just kind of expose it to cards exactly like this. Yep. You know, more specifically Lightning Bolt, but I guess in this position, if your draw is just Lightning Bolt or Lava Burst, then that's just not going to be enough to get yourself back on board. But that Flame Tongue totem essentially has charge anyway in the effect of what it does. So he could have loaded up another totem first and played the Flame Tongue afterwards, but really, really minor things in a game that was kind of 99.9% locked up either way.
Yeah, Hot Meowth was definitely a huge favorite at that point. Saiyan had already used his Lightning Storm as well, so I don't think there was just about anything he could have come back from with that draw.
Yeah, very true. And since we didn't cover the bans and the lineup in general at the top, both warriors have been banned, unsurprisingly. It's by far the most popular ban in competitive play these days. They are different warrior decks. One is a Dragon Warrior, one is the Power Cycle C'Thun list, but those two decks are very much established as two of the power decks in the format. The C'Thun list particularly has a lot of respect from some of the top players in the tournament, so no surprise to see those go down. Of course, Hot Meowth has picked up a win with his Shaman.
Yeah, and I definitely want to see Hot Meowth's Paladin deck here, the Anything Can Happen Ivory Knight deck. We've seen a lot of versions. You know, it's obviously with Ivory Knight now, there's new sort of tuning that goes into these. The fact that Ivory Knight can sometimes get another Anything Can Happen, can give you additional staying power, additional endgame explosiveness. Many of these decks for a while featured the Nazoth package as well.
Yes.
But you can be a little bit more compact now that it's just the Anything Can Happen engine going on.
Yeah, and it also brings up other questions about your deck building. Like, if you have the extra healing of Ivory Knight, do you still need both Forbidden Healings? Do you still need the Lay on Hands? You know, all these things come into question. But it's going to be the Freeze Mage from Just Saiyan, and he's managed to match it up against the Zoo, which is going to be a good matchup for him. We've seen a pretty epic game of Zoo versus Freeze Mage already today. Just Saiyan will be hoping that his game is a little bit more straightforward, which, based on his list, it probably will be, because the list we saw before with
the
11 duplicate Reno deck was a little bit more clunky.
Yeah, Saiyan is playing a pretty straightforward version of Freeze Mage. He is playing the Flame Strike, which has been sort of, there's basically that one flex slot in most of the Freeze Mage decks that we've seen these days. It's Flame Strike, maybe it's a Mirror Image, maybe it's a Cone of Cold.
Right.
Is choosing to play Flame Strike. What do you think that the specific metagame conditions are that you might want one or the other there?
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult to say. Flame Strike, most people's initial instinct is, oh, it's great against Zoo, but a lot of the time it just kind of isn't. Like, Blizzard does the job just fine. Frost Nova Doomsayer does the job just fine. And, you know, even Kona Cold will be better against Zoo a lot of the time than Flame Strike will. So Flame Strike is generally a stronger card against, say, Dragon Warrior, where there's just more mid-rangey chunky minions. Mm-hmm. So 4 health is kind of the number in that deck. But generally, you just see, like, flavors of Freeze Mage cycling in and out, and let's be honest, what most players do is not think about how to build their Freeze Mage and instead just go to @laughinghs on Twitter and find whatever the most recent list that he posted was.
That's fair. It's a fair way to go about it. Basically, if I were looking to play Freeze Mage,
which
we would be in an alternate universe. But if I were, that's probably what I would do. Because I certainly wouldn't play enough games of it myself that I think I would know better.
Yeah, so Brian Kibler is jamming Freeze Mage, and Soddle is playing Reno C'Thun Shadow Priest while petting an adorable Pomeranian.
Ah, cats and dogs living together.
Yeah.
Mass hysteria.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, Possessed Villager is a low power start for the zoo. No real threat. Saiyan is just going to go ahead and leverage his hero power to start ticking away at this board. No real clock put on him with just the low power being developed. And Hot Meowth is going to take this opportunity to step up the pressure as much as he can. Just playing Knife Juggler here isn't as big a threat as Darkshire Councilman, so this immediately starts forcing the Freeze Mage to react.
Yeah, Saiyan, he's, I imagine, just going to use his Arcane Intellect to start drawing some cards here. There's not a huge, huge pressure from Hot Meowth just yet, though Councilman is the scariest thing that can be on the opposing side of the table at this stage of the game.
Yeah, and with that Frost Nova in hand already, he's really looking to hit a Doomsayer at this point. Loot Hoarder only, of course, drawing one card and not even really contesting to put any damage on the Darkshire Councilman, since he'll just get traded out by that 1-1. So, yeah, Arcane Intellect definitely looks like pretty much the only play available on that turn.
It is worth noting that Hot Meowth took a page out of Dr. Hippie's book and is actually playing two copies of Crazed Alchemist in his zoo deck. So he is certainly coming prepared for this particular matchup, or at least for the card Doomsayer in particular. So I imagine, because Saiyan knows that deck lists are public to these players, that he may be a little bit more cautious about relying on Doomsayer than otherwise.
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, looking at this list in detail, it's about as close as optimal against Freeze Mage as you can get. It's kind of just missing a Soulfire, which is a card that you would like to have, just be able to do damage from hand consistently. But he has Leeroy, which is much better just to be able to bank power overwhelmings on than Doomguard is from hand. So that's going to help him out. And of course, the double Crazed Alchemist, like you said, is just going to be a huge deal against Freeze Mage.
All right, and just Saiyan not really finding that Doomsayer to get killed by a Crazed Alchemist. The Alchemist is not currently in Hot Meowth's hand. Facing down not a terribly threatening board at this point, but already down to 17.
Yeah, very much so. And he is going to have to start to think about how to mitigate damage here, because he doesn't have the security of Ice Block in hand. He doesn't have the security of an Ice Barrier in hand. So he needs to start mitigating damage very quickly here. But as soon as you start spending entire turns as Freeze Mage to just stalling for a turn, you've kind of hit a roadblock. Like, what Freeze Mage wants to do is stall plus at least draw cards each turn. That's generally the idea. So he can do that this turn by, for example, like Frost Nova Loot Hoarder, at least potentially moves him forward a little bit, but then you're just kind of developing Loot Hoarder onto a board that has a Knife Juggler on it. Like, how bad is that for you? But honestly, he does have to start reducing some of this damage ASAP.
How reasonable is Loot Hoarder plus Acolyte of Pain?
It's scary. I mean, you are looking at, what, 6, 7, 8 damage, I guess?
It looks to be Acolyte plus Ping, it seems. So he's going to reduce a little bit of the damage on board and get at least one card off that Acolyte, we assume.
Ooh.
That was a nice draw for Hot Meowth that gives him the ability to clear the Acolyte, depending on how the Knife Juggler behaves.
Right. There is, of course, a 50-50 here available. Oh, doesn't work out for Saiyan. Hot Meowth looks up. I don't know if he's praising Yogg at the moment, but he seems pleased with something. That means this Acolyte can take a free trade here, but he might just even be considering
just going to the face
about whether we send all of this stuff downtown.
Yeah, just Saiyan is down to a very, very low life total, and Hot Meowth has access to Power Overwhelming plus Leeroy. Yeah, he's just going to go ahead and attack Saiyan down to 10. This means without Ice Block, which is drawn, but if Saiyan doesn't play it, then he's just going to die to Leeroy plus Power Overwhelming. Hot Meowth is going to give him all the cards he wants. And it looks like we may see Frost Nova plus the Ice Block, so the Leeroy lethal is denied. And Hot Meowth is very expressive.
He's a blast to watch. And this is actually now not too terrible of a situation for Saiyan, because he's at exactly 10. If Hot Meowth decides he just wants to pop this block at some point, he's going to be doing it at, you know, around 10 to 9, depending on what happens with knives from the Knife Juggler. And that's just still a bunch of security. Like, 9 is not the end of the world, especially after the Leeroy has been committed, and as I mentioned, a no Soulfire list.
Yeah, that would leave Hot Meowth with very little ability to actually break block from hand. His only charge being in the deck is Leeroy.
Yes.
He could find a Soulfire from a Peddler or something like that, but other than that, he's going to be reliant on actually keeping minions on the board. And just Saiyan has been building up quite a hand that he can use to Blizzard and Nova his way into the later turns.
Yeah, sure can. And now he's starting to get access to enough mana where he can start doing those kind of plays that we talked about, where it's, you know, lock your board out and cycle some cards at the same time. And it's all progressing towards that Alexstrasza that he has in his hand. So if he can find a decent clear here, keep his ice block intact, and then still have that Alexstrasza available to him in both modes, right? Have the flexibility of being aggressive or defensive because he still has his block up, then suddenly we'll be in business.
Yeah, and this Acolyte has been absolutely huge. He's gotten the full three card draw. Well, he will get the full three cards off of it once it it does attack into something else or he pings it. But definitely a huge impact on this game so far, finding him a lot of resources.
And there is Crazed Out number one for Hot Meowth, but not a single Doomsayer has been drawn for Saiyan so far. So the Crazed Alchemist here may be just used to commit for lethal here if he ever gets another minion to attack, but that is not looking too likely with the current texture of Just Saiyan's hand. He can lock out the board for another turn here. He can draw another card, having essentially two card draws sat on the board. And then if he's able to pick up just a small piece of damage, he has the auto win locked up with Alexstrasza into burn from hand.
Yeah, this is looking great for Just Saiyan here. And we were talking a little bit earlier about how, you know, obviously this is such a good matchup for Freeze Mage in general, but that Laughing was actually calling it absolutely trivial. And we're seeing that this is perhaps why, as this game is, you know, it looked like Saiyan was under some pressure, but once he turned that corner, he has just not given up any kind of control whatsoever.
So he looked like he was deciding between the Ice Barrier and the Arcane Intellect that turn. If he has the read on the fact that there's Leroy Power Overwhelming in hand, then playing the Ice Barrier would have meant that he 100% keeps his Ice Block up next turn, which gives him maximum security at being able to do offensive Alexstrasza on the turn after. But he just chooses to cycle some cards here, which I don't think is 100% necessary, because as long as this Loot Hoarder commits to the face, then he has enough damage to get the job done anyway. But I guess he is, there's the potential of Voidwalkers and Defender of Argus that can lock that out. So probably slightly higher percentage there in the long run to play the Arcane Intellect.
So well, he's kind of just got an embarrassment of riches here. Doesn't really need much help at all. Hot Meowth looks kind of despondent now, which is kind of how I feel like I must look all the time when I'm playing against Freeze Mage. Again? Oh, I can't attack with any of my guys. Okay, your turn. I just got these guys.
What else am I supposed to do than attack with minions?
All right, well, Hot Meowth is going to go ahead and take this opportunity to break the ice block. He recognizes the threat of Alexstrasza coming down next turn, so he needs to break this now to ensure that that is not a possible option for Just Saiyan.
Yeah, it's actually just an incredibly strong play from Hot Meowth. He knows, like, he can see the setup from Just Saiyan. Mm-hmm. Basically, yeah, he can see the Alexstrasza in his future. This is the only thing he can do to prevent that from happening. You know, long term, this is probably still not a game you are winning against the hand size of your Freeze Mage opponent right now, but doing anything except Leroy Power Overwhelming at that point basically gives auto to the Freeze Mage.
Yeah, if there's an Alexstrasza in the opposing hand, just comes down and the game ends more or less in the spot. There's still the mechanical motions of pointing burn spells to your opponent's face.
It's tricky stuff.
Well, the Blizzard plus Ice Block, and now just saying, yep, just going at your face. I've locked this up with the Ice Block on board, and now we're kind of in the same situation that we were in just last turn, where we're going to see the Alexstrasza come down, and it's going to end up making this essentially a formality.
Yeah, Forbidden Ritual, two Flame Imps in hand, two completely useless Crazed Alchemists.
Oh, no, preventing one damage from Loot Hoarder. That is not useless.
There is the Flame Strike, but more importantly, do we just have him covered here with damage? There is three on board, which means our opponent is at 14. Fireball Torch is 9. Two Ice Lances is 13, and we don't have the mana to ping. Awkward.
Not quite.
Crazed Alchemist has actually just prevented lethal.
You said it was useless.
I did. What do I know?
Apparently nothing.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, Just Saiyan still has the opportunity to just Alex face here, send his minions in, and then I believe just finish the game off with Burn next turn if he wants, so.
Yeah, seems fine.
Okay. Looks like he's just going to go ahead and Flame Strike.
Yeah, I mean, this sets up anyway, right? Like, you push the extra little bit of damage that you need, you get to develop an Ice Barrier, you keep your minions in play, you're still ahead on board against one of the best board decks in the game.
Now you've said that the Flame Strike wasn't that good against you. It wasn't necessary, certainly, but
is this just belittle everything Sotal says day? Is that what this is? Damn.
What day is it? Oh, yes, then it is.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
Damn. I just bring the savage out on you all of a sudden, Kibla. What is happening here?
All right, well, Hot Meowth, refill the board with essentially useless minions.
Hey! If just in case we didn't have him covered before, the Frostbolt will do the job nicely. Just saying, bringing himself back into this game. And that, after the initial aggression, did look a lot more like the standard Freeze Mage versus Zoo that we're used to seeing, where the Zoo just kind of flounders hopelessly in the end of the game and just cannot get the job done.
Yeah, how foolish of him to want to attack with minions.
Jeez.
Ridiculous.
Brian, who hurt you? Which Freeze Mage player hurt you?
All of them.
Okay. It's a mighty, mighty fine deck played by connoisseurs of the game.
I believe that you believe that.
I believe that you do not.
Well, I do think it's a very powerful deck, as okay. It has shown many times on stream, including this one.
Yes. Anyway, the Freeze Mage, Brian will be pleased, is gone from this series now, but I'm sure we'll see at least one more Freeze Mage game over the course. It's kind of the theme, right, that generally when we get down to kind of top eights towards the second day, there are usually one or two Freeze Mages hanging around.
We've seen, I think, the distribution of players playing Freeze Mage who make it to the top of the standings has been extreme.
Yeah.
We saw George C., Dr. Yes. Hippie last week, Twist as well. Mm-hmm. Three of the top eight players, when not even a fraction close to that, three of eight actually brought Freeze Mage to the tournament. So definitely a deck that statistically overperformed in players' lineups overall.
Yeah, and it kind of makes sense just as a deck archetype, right? Because by its nature, Freeze Mage is incredibly polarizing, and when it's right to play it, it's right. When it's wrong to play it, it's wrong. So as long as there is a fraction of players who have made that right read that it's correct to bring Freeze Mage, then it will usually do pretty well.
In some sense, it's always wrong.
Morally,
in a karmic sense.
Yes, all right. Hot Meowth is going to go and queue with his Zoo deck again here. He's going to run into the Druid of Just Saying, and this is a matchup that does kind of swing back and forth, mostly around that card on the far right of Saiyan's hand. It's all about, can the Druid do things quickly to slow down the Zoo's development? Even often wild growth in this matchup can be too slow.
Yeah, this is a very, very explosive matchup each way. And Saiyan here, I think he's just going for a turn one Fandral. This is a very ambitious play, I think, because if his opponent does have power overwhelming, he's now used all of his resources to ramp to get that trade basically two for one.
I think this play is usually correct, just based on the texture of your hand and the opening that your opponent has led with. Dire Peddler. What's the card? One mana, 1/1 Death Rattle Guy.
No,
Death Rattle Guy.
Oh, Death Rattle Guy.
Possessed Villager. So if it was Possessed Villager that you got led with, then suddenly you can be a little bit scared of power overwhelming. But you've 2.5'd yourself there with the sure. coin and the innovate, and if it's power overwhelming that kills the minion as well, then that's not too bad for you. And the payoff, if they don't have exactly power overwhelming,
it's
enormous.
True. All right, well, we see Raven Idol into Starfall. So Saiyan with a lot of options and now a lot of AoE removal. Hot Meowth does have Imp Gang Boss. Pretty much the best turn three for this matchup, please.
Sure. Ooh. Innovate number two now presents Saiyan with options here. He can innovate that Nourish and just pull himself up closer towards that Ancient of War.
If you're just going to draw Innovate number two, then do whatever you want.
Right.
You see, that Hot Meowth he loves the eye roll. He really does. Innovate into Nourish is going to leave Just Saiyan with a huge mana advantage here, very, very close to that big tree.
Yep. And next turn, we just occupy ourselves by maybe wrathing something and dropping a hero power, or we Starfall if there's just some crazy board that appears out of nowhere with, say, Forbidden Ritual. And then that's kind of job done at that point. We filled the turn we need, and then we jam Ancient of War. But Hot Meowth, with his Peddler, does pick up Power Overwhelming number two, which can be a very big deal, especially since he still has that Abusive Sergeant left open from the opener, which was actually a key break point in the game because he had the mana available to play that alongside the Power Overwhelming turn on turn two. And chose to hold on to it.
Yeah, Saiyan now. Starfall has to look at least a little bit appealing. You take a ton of damage off the board. It's not necessarily great though, because it's your only real answer to the Forbidden Ritual at this point.
Yeah.
But your next turn is definitely going to be Ancient.
Yes.
You can also just Wrath and play the Mire Keeper, which if you kill the Direwolf Alpha, you leave yourself in a pretty reasonable position on the board.
Yeah, it's not too bad, especially since this is kind of one of those rare situations where you can afford to play the 2-2, play it in stats mode here, yeah. Since you know you have your next play locked up and a ramping here for additional mana isn't really going to be a big deal, but right, Saiyan actually just decides to cycle and say, you know what, I have a decent play for stats on the board next turn, what I need is some more options moving forward, so he's obviously not too afraid, having I guess seen one Power Overwhelming, one Direwolf already, he thinks the efficiency of his Ancient War is going to be pretty high next turn.
Yeah, and this leaves him, you know, he has to recognize that if the Ancient of War, well, perhaps gets Crazed Alchemist, there's a lot of ways for Hot Meowth to actually punch through it. So
that is very true.
He recognizes that he needs to end up finding more gas, that Ancient of War alone potentially won't be quite enough to get the job done.
That is very true. I'd forgotten about the double Crazed Alchemist already. So yeah, Hot Meowth's potential to be able to punish this Ancient of War is actually pretty high, and we will see what his draw is here. Voidwalker not going to get the job done. So based on what we can see at the moment, what's the most efficient way to punch through this?
He has both Power Overwhelming and Abusive, yeah. So he's plus 6 on something if he wants it. Mm-hmm. He can get another plus 2 total from the Defender.
So he can Abusive this 5-5 up to a 7-7, Argus it up to an 8-8, but wasting your Argus buff on that. Right, exactly. Yeah. And then he can. It looks like he's just going to trade in the 2-2 and the 1-1, and then Argus afterwards, is he?
It looks like he may be. Yeah, he's going to go ahead and
Divine Shield
and the 1-1 here.
This looks about right.
This does set him up to get pretty heavily punished by that Starfire. It clears most of his board. If he traded in the 1-1 and the 2-2 and kept the Divine Shield, he'd be at least more stable against Starfall.
Yeah, I mean, this is
not what you expect
solid.
To see out of the Druid deck, but it's going to end up being exactly what he did not want to see. Eye roll number 12 or so of the match coming out of Hot Meowth there.
For those keeping count at home, yeah, that is indeed number 12. As you see on the screen, Lemurian, who we saw earlier, has defeated Bloodyface, who we also saw. So that's two players if you want to follow their progress after seeing them on. Bloodyface has unfortunately dropped out, but Hot Meowth at least has to be happy with the reasonable outcome from the mulch. Gets a decent chunky minion that he can drop on board here.
Oh, well, Just Saiyan has a pretty big minion of his own in Onyxia.
Yeah.
Daughter of Deathwing comes out. I think we're at 13.
Unlucky number 13, and yeah, Crazed Alchemist is pretty good at dealing with some shapes of big minion.
Not that one.
Not an 8-8. That is going to do very, very little.
And decides to go ahead and pump or flip that so he can take out one of the 1-1s and send 5 damage to the face here. Saiyan finds Living Roots. It's actually a pretty big deal because it can allow him to clear off more of this board. Right now, Saiyan's just trying to protect his life total. He's
yes.
at just 11 health and has no taunts available to him at the moment.
Yeah, so the question here, I think, is Wild Growth and Living Roots are being played for sure this turn, mm-hmm. almost certainly. It's just a matter of whether he wanted to leave mana available to himself before developing the Violet Teacher, so he had more flexibility with things he were to draw off the Wild Growth, but he looks like he's going to value the tokens here. And we'll see what he'll draw here. Haven't seen a swipe from his deck yet. Druid the Claw is exactly one of those cards that he could have had access to if he chose not to play the Violet Teacher.
Yeah, and Onyxia will chomp down on this councilman, I imagine. Oh, no, he's going to go ahead and... Oh, he's taking out the Living Roots. Never mind. Onyxia's going to kill the 5-5.
Yeah, which is just wrong, as Saiyan is now realizing.
Yeah, I was going to say, he's going to attack the councilman, then he didn't attack the councilman.
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
Yeah, he gets a little bit of extra damage on his Onyxia here.
Which is a really big deal.
Yeah, that gives Hot Meowth the ability to kill it much more easily. It's a lot easier to do 3 with this board. And if Hot Meowth picks up Leroy, he's 1 damage off lethal here.
Mm-hmm.
And
that is just a Crazed Alchemist, which, again, is more or less useless. It can flip the Violet Teacher on this occasion in the interest of being pedantic so I don't get called out by Brian Kibler again. But
not useless.
Right, but flipping the Violet Teacher isn't going to do a great deal since your priority trade target here is the Onyxia, so you would just be buffing your opponent's board.
And if Saiyan had attacked the other way, that would not the Onyxia would not be vulnerable to removal here.
Right, exactly.
It would have 5 health remaining, and you know, Saiyan, you know, he's emoted a little that, you know, that was a mistake at his face in his hands here, but he's still in a pretty commanding position right now. He has a very strong board. Hot Meowth, you know, picked up that that Alchemist, which is not what he was looking for. Only able to clear off a little bit of the board here. And I have to think, I mean, is he just going to go to the face with this? These tokens, going to the face leaves Leeroy plus Power Overwhelming as a possible lethal out.
Yeah.
Gonna hold on to Crazed Alchemist.
But it looks unfortunate, because just purely on the quality of the two minions that are in hand for Saiyan already, it looked very much like he was going to get outvalued just by these drops coming down. But now with the Nourish as well to back it up, there is a very, very finite window here for Hot Meowth to try and push through this. He does have the Crazed Alchemist now, which can potentially do some work on the Druid of the Claw, but his clock is extremely short right now to try and push through these last points of damage that he needs. Flame Imp is just not what you need right now.
And this is certainly not looking good for Hot Meowth. He is setting, I think he's setting himself up for lethal here. He's gonna go ahead and flip the bear.
Uh-huh.
There we go.
There you go, buddy. Have some extra damage.
It wasn't useless.
I mean, that is in fact worse than
maybe
useless.
Maybe Saiyan will, you know, he'll just decide to play Yogg.
Maybe. There is always hope that just Saiyan wants to live for the story.
I might do it.
You definitely would.
I don't know, if I were in this spot, I probably wouldn't.
Mm.
I approach games very differently depending on the context, you see.
I don't know, I think you'd do it. I think deep down in your soul, you just would not be able to resist.
I mean, there is a part of my soul that would die a little bit if I didn't. If
right,
I drew
exactly.
Yogg and just decided not to play it.
Mm. And that part is valuable. I mean, you'd just never be able to get that back.
No.
Anyway,
RIP.
Just Saiyan going up to a 2-1 lead. So he now only has his aggro shaman left to win with, and he is up against the Zoo, which is it's going to be a slightly difficult matchup for him. But then there's the kind of the X factor here, which is the aggro shaman against this new build of the Anyfin Paladin.
And we have lots of background of statistics and matchup data and everything for so many of these decks, but this is a new deck.
Yeah,
this is a deck that is built in large part around the Ivory Knight, which was just recently released from Karazhan. So exactly how this influences the matchups for the overall Anyfin control Paladin-style archetype is not really clear.
Right. And I think Ivory Knight against Zoo is of particular use because a lot of the time, Zoo is very much a look at the board state and react to it with a specific answer or you lose. And like Ivory Knight can provide you with that specific answer a bit more consistently because of the Discover effect.
Yeah, it does a lot of things against Zoo. The life gain can be crucial. You know, you can often just need to buy yourself a little bit of time. The fact that it's a 4-4 body, totally reasonable sized, just minion on the board that can help contest things.
Yep.
And yeah, it cards that could be pretty terrible in other matchups, like Avenging Wrath.
Sure.
It would be great against Zoo. Gain 6 life, and oh, okay, next turn I'll just blow up all your 1/1s.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, the good news when you are playing literally the Anyfin deck with Ivory Knights in it is that there is never the internal turmoil of, am I going to pick Anyfin here just to take the 10 heal? Like, no, I'm always taking
Anyfin. Yeah,
I don't
know if you're always going to take it.
All right.
But it's definitely a pretty attractive option compared to other decks where you're not going to really get anything.
Right, it's just literally 6-mana 4/4 heal for 10, which is a card that would see play in control decks for sure.
Yes.
But there are pretty much almost always superior options in terms of being able to control the board at the same time. And it looks like we are going to see this matchup straight away that we talked about. So I'm fascinated to see how this one plays out. Just Saiyan is off to a pretty aggressive start here, just dropping the Abusive Sergeant on turn one to get the damage through, backing it up with a Totem Golem.
Yeah, he's getting a good amount of pressure there. A lot of people will like to hold on to their Abusive Sergeants in a lot of matchups. This is definitely not one of them. This is a matchup where it's very important that the Shaman gets as much pressure as possible early on. So you don't really care about the Battle Cry. You just want the 2-1 body in this particular instance.
Right. And just saying, choosing to forego the Argent Squire here just to play the Totem. Of course, with the texture of his hand, Thing from Below in hand, there is merit in playing the Totem here. He also is just able to pick up Taunt Totem, which would theoretically protect his Totem Golem from Coin True Silver removal. So a lot of good things in playing the Totem that turn.
Hot Meowth has a Bluegill Warrior, which is not just a combo tool. It's a removal spell, too.
Yep. Tunnel Trog picked up doesn't quite fit the curve right now, and he is just going to put a big 5-5 taunt in the way of this Bluegill Warrior, which even now if it is buffed by a War Leader is not big enough to make an imposition on this 5-5, and that just allows him to keep on threatening face damage here.
Yeah, Hot Meowth, I think, was hoping to use that Bluegill along with Wild Pyromancer to get a full clear on the board after a turn, but the Thing from Below definitely puts a wrinkle in that plan. Kind of an awkward spot now for him. He can potentially use Aldor to shrink it, but he's still taking a lot of damage on the attack back.
All right, and it still just does nothing to protect that Bluegill Warrior as well. It just still means that that's just going to get no value in terms of taking out these other minions on the board. And the other thing this 5-5 does, to an extent, it's in matchups like this where there is, you know, ultimate hard removal in the form of, you know, a quality clears or, say, Brawl from a Control Warrior, is it's a huge minion that your opponent often feels forced to react to with some of their premium spells. And when you have that 4-mana 7-7 in hand, you don't necessarily always just want to jam it at the earliest opportunity because it can get punished by their premium removal, so the 5-5 at least gives a tentative test, but since there was a neutralization tool in the form of the Aldor, he won't be 100% convinced there's no hard removal, but at the same time, an Aldor has just been used on the 5-5 and not your 7-7, so.
And Saiyan is going to slow roll that that Flame Wraith Faceless, going to go ahead and try to get as much damage out of this board as he can, trying to play around the possibility of sweepers like the Wild Pyromancer plus quality, and yeah, just sends everything to the face.
Yeah.
Well, lightning bolts down the Aldor to protect his other minions.
Yeah, just like valuing one to the dome over the threat of, you know, any punish that could come out from leaving the 2-1. That's how all in he is on dealing damage in this game. Just the mere fact of one damage to the face he chose to throw in there.
Did he decide to sacrifice his Wild Pyromancer here to ensure that he could Solemn Vigil? Because he could have coined first.
No, five minions died regardless.
So he could have coined first and then played Pyromancer Consecration, which would have still killed all of Saiyan's board, I believe.
Pyromancer Consecration, there was an Argent Squire, that dies, everything else had three, yeah. Yeah, he could have a 3-1 Pyromancer right now, I believe.
And that would be able to clear this Tunnel Trog, so that yep. You know, may have been a little bit of a missed sequence from Hot Meowth that led to his Pyromancer's demise.
Follow the rule.
Yeah, Aldor Peacekeeper number 2 is a very big deal here. Just Sam would definitely have been within his rights to think he might be able to dodge this, having seen one come down, but that 4-mana 7-7 is looking a little bit more balanced these days, and the Aldor has neutralized the threat for now. And actually, you know, despite the potential misstep on the previous turn, Hot Meowth is actually looking in a reasonably comfortable position. Even if Doomhammer were to be picked up here to just start forcing through massive amounts of damage, the Forbidden Healing and an Ivory Knight both in hand.
Yeah, Hot Meowth with a lot of tools here. Sam picks up a Tuskar Totemic, not really what he wants right now. If he can find a, not gonna go with that. He's gonna go ahead and Sir Finley, hoping to find Life Tap, and there it is. So digging for some more options. I believe that is 14 for eye rolls from Hot Meowth.
Yeah. Yeah, we're getting up there. He's going for the record. I'm not sure what the record is. I think it may have been set by Boar Control during DreamHack and his run towards the top eight there, which I'm not sure if you caught. But
I did not. No.
Yeah, it was pretty spectacular. That guy and Hot Meowth, they would get along. They're both very expressive guys.
Look at Sir Finley. He's looking tough.
He is.
He's been
yeah.
working out.
Yeah, and he's also threatening to just mess up that anything pool for the opponent and just start ripping Sir Finley Murgleton's back off them.
Yeah, that is a kind of unusual element that Sir Finley adds to this particular matchup. The fact that your opponent isn't guaranteed their lethal combo. Though this particular matchup, it's not really how you win.
Not hugely important. Small side note, I did once see Savitz play Milrogue against Anyfin Paladin, and the opponent just tried to Anyfin for lethal and got like five cold lights. Yeah, that was glorious.
I had an Anyfin from my opponent that got back my cold light oracle that I got off an evolve that just ruined him.
Yeah, so Ivory Knight now coming down on an empty board, picks up a quality. Doesn't need the healing too badly at this point, especially with the second Ivory Knight already in hand. And now with the Equality in combination with the Pyromancer, he has defense against Burst with the second Ivory Knight. He has defense against Board with the Pyromancer Equality and the Doomsayer. So things are looking rosy. Everything is coming up Meowth right now.
Just Saiyan is really looking for Doomhammer. He has both Rockbiter weapons in his hand. And Hot Meowth he can hopefully get him to a position where he's sitting at that magic 16 life going into his turn, and not able to just heal himself up repeatedly. But Hot Meowth is well, okay, maybe we're not going to get him to down in life at all ever again, as Ragnaros is picked up from Hot Meowth, though not necessarily even his best play this turn, because he can guarantee both some life gain and a. And a board presence from this Ivory Knight.
All right, I was going to say, if Hot Meowth did not pick Stand Against Darkness there,
I'd be very confused about what the plan was, yeah.
Yeah, Doomhammer was one of the next two cards from Just Saiyan. He would actually just have Lethal.
Yeah.
So, pretty important pickup that he was able to get a high-value healing card there off the... Ooh, hang on. He's actually not committing to the board here. He still has it because there is not a board clear.
If Saiyan finds Doomhammer right now, he does not. He can still life tap, but that he will not quite have lethal.
He'll only be able to deal a total of
21 damage without the lava burst. Lightning Storm
is not terrible, but the 4/4s are looking a little bit awkward. But you know, how important is this storm to your long-term game plan? Like, sure, we can storm away some Murlocs when an Anyfin comes down, but if your opponent was in a secure enough position to cast Anyfin, you have probably lost the game anyway.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not really a card that you react to very well when you're playing an aggressive deck.
Mm-hmm.
And Saiyan, deep in thought here, debating exactly what options he may have.
Yeah, and you can see what it means to him on his face right now. He knows that this matchup is supposed to be his matchup. The other one that he has left is the Zoo deck, which is notoriously, favorable against the aggro Shaman. So the Storm is, of course, teched in here for that purpose. But Saiyan knows the importance of this. If he wants to keep his run going through this tournament towards the Summer Championships, he knows that this matchup is the really big one for him that he's supposed to take down.
Yeah. One issue there is if he actually wanted to cast both Feral Spirits and Lightning Storm, he would be locking himself out of Doomhammer plus double Rockbiter next turn.
Mm.
If he draws Rockbiter, he can still play it with both Doomhammers as of now. And this makes... Oh, True Silver is definitely attractive here for Hot Meowth. He's going to go ahead and take out the minion. He'll be at... still... just out of range of Rockbiter plus double Doomhammer, up to 20 life.
Wow, Rockbiter plus double Doomhammer sounds terrifying.
Rockbiter plus double Doomhammer.
That is not a combination
dual
I ever
wield.
Want to see. Yeah, all
right. Not exactly what I had in mind, but... And then all of a sudden, we got a lot of recruits here. There's Doomhammer, but it's not enough.
Ooh.
There is Lightning Storm here.
Yeah, I mean...
And that can clear this board. It's guaranteed to clear this board, but he will not have the damage next turn and the mana he needs.
Right.
It also, unfortunately for Saiyan, clears off. He'd love to leave one damaged minion in play.
Right.
So that Ragnaros isn't guaranteed to heal the face.
Yeah. So yeah, the Storm does come out. Totem Golem is going to come down, which is going to deal, essentially one damage to the Paladin here because of the swing from the True Silver. But I'm sure we are going to see Ragnaros Lightlord come down here, and Saiyan is going to have to find some kind of fancy way. We're going to be looking at like some way to put a small amount of damage onto the Lightlord himself, and then your opponent whiffs on the healing for several turns, and you're able to send this Doomhammer damage through. Like, it's a really niche outcome where you win this game, but Saiyan probably won't be giving up all hope just yet.
Argent Squire is not going to do it.
It is not.
He can life tap into... he really has to like lightning bolt the Ragnaros or something like that just to give himself any chance of assembling enough damage here.
Well, so here's the thing. This next heal that the Ragnaros will have is not particularly relevant. It's a heal for three, right? So
sure,
you could let that one happen and just hope that your Argent Squire gets to poke the 8-8 for one on the following turn. I mean, that might be your best
work. But you're
going
to die to an 8-8 pretty soon.
Yes,
you're 20 life.
Right? I mean, how are we winning this game? I'm trying to search through the ether for a world where we win, and I'm struggling to find it.
It is tough to find. Because if he life taps, then he can't Doomhammer and do anything else.
I think I just like Squire Doomhammer go face. I think that is probably the highest percentage win line from, it's something like a 0% win up to a 0.001% win.
All right, he's actually just going to double Rockbiter. He's going to kill Ragnaros and go face.
Wow. Okay, then.
All right, well, he's dealt with the Ragnaros, but... Now he's in a position where he has most of his burst is gone. And Hot Meowth is going to be able to claw back into the game as far as life total is concerned. Not that he needs to claw back into anything here. He's firmly in the driver's seat, getting himself back up to 21. Both Rockbiter's gone, so Saiyan looking pretty hopeless here.
Yeah, and this is definitely the right way to sequence this. He could have played his Anyfin here just to set up lethal that way, but he's still setting up lethal with the Anyfin from hand on the following turn. And this line has the added bonus of just picking himself up 2 extra life from the True Silver in the process. So again, slight min-maxing from Hot Meowth to make sure he plays around ridiculous outcomes. I can't even imagine what combination of cards would deal 19 damage to him in that situation with both Rockbiters gone.
But yeah. I mean, Saiyan drew Doomhammer, double Rockbiter, double Lava Burst, and wasn't really even close.
It was just
to
not having in the neighborhood.
No. Just so much healing between the Ivory Knights, the Ragnaros, the Forbidden Healing.
Yep. Yeah,
that deck seems like it's real.
It seems like a real thing, yeah. Ivory Knight definitely seems at its most powerful in that deck. I've seen it being used in Nazoth decks, and after my initial impression that it was going to be really good, I was a tiny bit disappointed in how it actually played. We saw Dog, for example, playing Nazoth with just 1 in the list, but it seems like if you're playing anything Paladin, it's an auto 2 of in that list at the moment, it seems like.
Yeah, it seems like a very, very powerful card.
Yeah. So now we are going to come all the way down to this final game. This is a game as old as time as far as the Hearthstone meta is concerned. Zoo just, versus Aggro Shaman.
It's as old as Totem Golem, I would
say. Right, it's actually not that old at all.
Not really. It wasn't even that long.
Brian.
It wasn't even that long ago. People were like, oh, Shaman's so weak. It's the worst class. Yeah. And now people are like, oh my God, stop with the Shaman already. Yeah, actually, they're saying stop with the Shaman, but, you know.
Also true, yeah. But there's kind of an indefinite loop with Hearthstone where, you know, people will complain that the weakest class is the weakest class, and then they will get strong cards, and then start complaining about all these strong cards that they have. It's a vicious cycle.
Well, it's kind of like, the funny thing about Priest is that people complain about Priest even when it's losing. They're like, I hate getting my stuff stolen and losing to it.
Right.
It's like, that happens so rarely.
Yeah.
But it's just such an emotional response people have.
Yeah.
They complain about it even when it's bad.
Yeah.
Which is kind of part of the plight of Priest, really.
Yeah, so just to let you know, one of the players has just requested a quick bathroom break. Of course, this is an extended series. We're going all the way down to game 5, and we want these players to be as comfortable as they can for this hugely important 5th game. So it's going to go relieve some tension in the bathroom, and then they'll be back ready to play at full effect for this last game.
I'll just leave that one there.
Yeah, that probably wasn't the most optimal choice of words, was it? Moving forward.
Anyway.
Yeah. So
we have Zoo versus Aggro Shaman.
Exactly.
We've seen this matchup all the time over the past week or so, at least, the past season or so, really.
Mm-hmm.
This is definitely a situation in which typically the Zoo deck is ahead, though.
Yeah.
Hot Meowth is playing the version with the double Crazed Alchemist and Leeroy, which is certainly weaker against other decks that are playing to the board compared to the Doomguard versions that have that ability to charge clear rather than just finish the game.
Yeah, and it's, you know, people talk about this being an unfavored matchup for Shaman. It's not colossally unfavored. There are definitely starts that interact very well for the Shaman. If you just go, why are you smirking at me like that?
What? I'm not.
You're giving me that Kibler face, as if you're just deeply amused with me.
I can't stop giving you a Kibler face.
Yeah, not a face, Brian. Okay, yeah, there we go. As I was about to say, there are starts that just interact very favorably. You know, things like Coin Totem Golem can be very effective. You know, one drop Coin Rockbiter to take down their first drop. You know, if they can really get a platform in the early turns using those kind of starts, as we see Rockbiter has been picked up here by Just Saiyan, but it is all about that battle for early board control. Whoever is, you know, visibly ahead with something as early as, you know, turn 2 or 3 is almost overwhelmingly favored to come out on top.
And typically that's a big part of the reason why Zoo tends to be favored, because the Shaman deck has a lot of cards like Lava Burst that aren't necessarily great at fighting for the board early. They're great at finishing the game off late.
Yeah.
But whereas Zoo has a lot of cheap minions, you know, there's what, a dozen cards that cost 1 in the typical Zoo deck, including Abusive Sergeant, Power Overwhelming, lots of ways to make favorable trades early in the game.
Yeah, I mean, the science of Zoo, this is one of the oldest decks in the game, and the refinement of this deck has basically come down to the point of just ensuring that you are ahead on turn 2 or 3 every single game. That's what the deck is built for, because if you cannot do that, your win percentage is extremely low. So it does come down to exactly that in this matchup. And here we go, game 5 of this hugely important series. Both players with solid openers, Squire into Abusive Sergeant, backed up by Rockbiter Weapons and Feral Spirits, is definitely a high percentage draw for Shaman in this matchup, but as you mentioned, there just really aren't bad Zoo draws most of the time. You just, it's really hard to whiff with this deck.
Yeah, it's one of the reasons that Zoo is such a popular and powerful deck is that it has so much redundancy. There's so many things that you can do on turn one, then a bunch of things on turn two.
Right.
And your cards, in many cases, are very much interchangeable, which is very different than sort of mid-range or controlling style decks, where you need to have specific things at specific times.
Yeah, exactly. And the option here of abusive and Rockbiter weapon, which could have lined up really, really well into, you know, particular opponents where if he just drops Dark Peddler here, for example, instead of just loading up on one drops, it would have looked a lot better. But that Argent Squire isn't looking particularly imposing on any of these minions. If he Rockbiters down the 1-3, then what use is this Argent Squire really? So I'm not sure if maybe it's even just Coin Feral Spirits.
I was actually
this turn.
Just looking at that the possibility to, you know, keep your opponent from having a really effective turn. He is going to go ahead and use the Flame Tongue. I actually like this too. The only thing that this is really bad against would be something like a Direwolf Alpha or something fancy coming off Dark Peddler. Mm-hmm. But he is going to go ahead and clear off the Argent Squire, leaving just the Flame Tongue up.
Yeah, so I suppose if you coin Feral Spirits, you are essentially giving up one of those Spirit Wolves for nothing. You give it up to a Deathrattle or a Divine Shield and two health on the Voidwalker, so you're essentially just investing a 2-2 on the board, whereas the Flame Tongue Totem play had the same upside of disrupting your opponent's turn three sometimes. But still, just went ahead and developed the Imgang boss on curve here. And the reason why Zoo is so favored in a lot of these matchups comes a long way down to exactly this card, Imgang boss.
I like this play, too, of using the Abusive Sergeant to clear off one of these minions. This makes Hot Meowth's ability to actually get through and kill the Flame Tongue much lower.
Yes.
Even if he does have Defender of Argus, he can only clear off one of these rather than be able to actually kill both of them, which he could with the 1-1.
Right. Remember, this is a no Soulfire list from Hot Meowth, and his only charge minion is Leroy Jenkins. So the number of minions that he has in play is literally the most impact he has on board. So if there are two minions in play, there is no way he can spread three sources of damage over the course
these
of the board.
These are the only things you have to attack with.
Yeah, exactly.
Figure it out from here.
Yeah.
And just saying, he does have those Rockbiter weapons still available. One quirk of Rockbiter weapon compared to a lot of other removal is that you have to have a target for each of them. Yes, you can use your face for some of them, but he can't say Rockbiter's face, attack the Argent Squire, then Rockbiter's face again, attack the Imgang boss, which he'd love to be able to potentially do in this spot, given the board state.
And yeah, the Rockbiter weapons again. I mean, they're usually such great tools in this matchup, but the lineup of Hot Meowth's board has just been as such that they've just been relatively ineffective here. Mm-hmm. It's just they're just not doing what he needs them to do in this situation. And the rest of his hand, you know, sure, Doomhammer is great if you're not significantly behind on the board, or if you're able to leverage it when you're ahead. But based on the position he's going to be in next turn, it's probably not going to be good enough to catch himself up. So he is just looking in a very, very awkward position here.
Yeah, and we're going to see the Rockbiter used. I wonder if we could see Rockbiter used on the totem to actually trade in. Yeah, this is kind of fancy. Rockbiter up your Flame Tug to clear off the 2-3 here. So this is a spot that I like that for sure, because as we were saying, it's so crucial for the Shaman not to fall too far behind. And the Flame Tongue was just going to get killed for free by one of these 1-1s.
Right.
So he's actually able to keep himself from just getting too far behind on this board.
There is a Soulfire, but no Mortal Coil, Elven Archer, any source of 1 damage, which is what I'm sure he would have been looking for primarily. Does get to develop the Voidwalker as well here, and I'm not gonna call it completely useless this time, but Hot Meowth has been drawing the Crazed Alchemist in very awkward situations. Yeah, they've not been too impressive so far.
We have not seen it look very good. Yeah. I'll definitely say that.
So Flame Wreath Faceless or Doomhammer here, it seems to be the decision, and that Voidwalker is very well timed from Hot Meowth, since Voidwalker into a Shaman turn 5 means that solo 1-drop basically tanks the entire 5-mana investment of your opponent for 1 turn.
And Saiyan really doesn't want to play Flame Wreath Faceless here and just get killed by a Power Overwhelming, so decides to use Doomhammer and start making inroads on Hot Meowth's board. Crucially, this gets Hot Meowth farther away from that Sea Giant.
Yes. Dark Peddler Dragon Egg Flame Imp comes down. So he is looking at the state of his board right now and saying, I have no Death Rattles, I have no Divine Shields, all my minions have two. Lightning Storm is a complete blowout right now. So he's taking the stickiest minion that he had available to him, which is the Dragon Egg.
Yeah, and saying it is in an okay spot here. He's able to use the Doomhammer to clear some of this board off and has access to Argent Horse Rider for some additional clear. So this, you know, this is still very much a game that could go either way.
It is, and as long as he kept limiting that Sea Giant, that was definitely potentially working in his favor, but now it has hit that magical number where he can play it if he wants to just spend the full investment here on an 8-8 on the board. And when you have Power Overwhelming in your hand and your opponent has started Doomhammering himself all the way down to 17 already, an 8-8 looks fairly appealing.
It definitely does. And Saiyan, you know, when he will have no minions on the board, Hot Meow will be able to use his Imp to clear off the Horse Rider, leaving just the Dragon Egg and the Sea Giant. Did we actually get a chance to see the Discover at all? I'm really curious.
We did not, no.
I was just trying to figure out the specifics. The specific combination of cards would lead him to take Dragon Egg.
Sure. Well, like I say, it was on that turn where Lightning Storm looked like it would just absolutely destroy him. So if there weren't any other, say, you know, three health minions or Death Rattles or Argent Squire, for example, then I can see it being taken just as a sticky minion.
That Stone Claw off of the Tusk Archetemic is really, really nice for just saying here.
Do you know why? Best card in the game.
Oh,
Crazed Alchemist. Oh. Boom.
You got it, man. Isn't useless at all. He's going to get a nice value Alchemist here. Well, value, quote unquote.
Yeah.
Killing the free the free totem off that Tusk Archetemic. But if it were not for the Alchemist, it would be able to protect the Flame Wreath faces or just Saiyan's face. I imagine we'll see the egg will take out the 3-2. Not quite lethal damage here, so just going to go ahead and clear the board. And yeah, now Hot Meowth is in a great spot, getting a Power Overwhelming target plus a 2-1 for his trouble from that that egg.
Yeah, just going to go and Ritual for 2 to fill his board as well. Gets another 2 buffs on the Darkshire Councilman. And now the threat of lethal is there. Just Saiyan is not going to find the answer here. I don't think even Taunt Totem is going to be enough to keep him around, right?
No, there's a lot of damage on the other side of the board. There is a Taunt Totem, but there's 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 through the totem. So
yeah, he can't even like engineer the board to make an inefficient attack go into the Taunt Totem. So there is just no outs here for Just Saiyan. He's going to quickly double check everything, and that is it. Hot Meowth drops the dab of all things at the end there, which is in keeping with his expressive nature so far.
He's a character.
He certainly is. Yeah. I mean, you'd have to be if you're going to name yourself Hot Meowth, right?
Seems so.
Yeah. So anyway, if you want to keep track of Hot Meowth's progress, I'm sure we'll keep you up to date with him throughout the tournament. You can follow him along in the bracket as well if you want to open up that page. But he is definitely a new character that people would have been introduced for. And if nothing else, I mean, what else is the Hearthstone Championship Tour initiative great for if not introducing people to that haven't had a chance to share the spotlight so far?
It's just for finding Hot Meowth. That's it.
Fair enough. And on that note, I have nothing more to add. So let's see if TJ can follow that.
Thanks very much, guys. Really interesting match watch. We've had a lot of games go to, a lot of matches go to game five today. I'm joined at the blackboard by Frodan. A little bit of a bummer, Dan. Got to see your teammate Just Saiyan fall.
Yeah, it is what it is, though. Saiyan, hey, trying to talk over here, Kibler. Keep it down. Gosh, I can hear his maniacal laughter from all the way over here. Unfortunately, players have to lose. As two players walk in, one player has to lose. I think people have a hard time grasping this concept when they're being really competitive. They sometimes let the salt get over them. But it happens. And Saiyan did not play perfectly. There was opportunities for him to even seize the entire series advantage to win, I think. But he's not eliminated just yet. So hopefully we can see him come back.
Yeah, a lot of known players still left in the tournament there. You can see as we go through. Started with 168, now down to less than 60. So we're actually getting through pretty quick. Day one, it's a bloodbath. Definitely, you can see a lot of Latin American players still remaining, and a couple of them still left in the upper bracket. And very little Tavern Heroes remaining. Is that just three or four?
I see. Well, K-Feld actually just got eliminated.
But you guys
saw on screen, you saw Rosti, the guy who qualified for the Spring Championship, got to the finals, did end up getting really far too and eliminating him.
Yeah, and there you can see some footage from the Salt Lake City venue. Those guys looking like they're enjoying themselves. Lots of Hearthstone themed t-shirts and girls. And girls. That's correct.
Let's be very neutral and accepting. Yeah. TJ.
Yeah, well, I mean, speaking of girls as well.
About accessibility.
Emily S2 actually defeated Chalky. Eliminated Chalky from the tournament. So she's going to go ahead and move through on the lower bracket. Still a lot of matches left to win in the lower bracket, but definitely a good one. Nossum did defeat Raze, but then immediately after fell in the tournament. So Nossum, another player, been eliminated.
Dog is going strong. Dog is a player that I was thinking about picking originally because I just love his lineup too. It's between Dog and Fibonacci. I thought both those guys brought really fun decks. And if you haven't checked it out, you should definitely see what he's brought to the tournament. It's really cool.
Yeah, but Fibonacci went ahead and fell as well. So he's been eliminated by Noblord, which means, Dan, we got quite a few names.
We have several that we have to eliminate here.
Yeah. All right. Well, first one, that was Chalky. That was Core's pick. He's going to go out. And with that, he is also, I believe, mathematically eliminated from the last call since he didn't place high enough. So, unfortunately, Chalky's road on HCT is going to end here. We're also going to have to eliminate Nostim and Fibonacci. So, only...
Let me hold this for you, TJ. You're
Thanks,
too strong.
Man.
That dad bod strength's really coming in.
Yeah, definitely with chalkboard. So powerful with chalk is my only weapon.
Be careful.
Only four players left remain on the board now. So there's actually a couple of our caches who have been eliminated completely.
Yeah, that's right. Sane, as you just saw from Sottle, was in the winner's portion, did fall, but he still can just win a couple series, go to day two. Rosti's still going strong, as you also saw. He was able to take out K-Felt. Frozen is looking like a beast. I think that's one of the better picks of the entire tournament. Yep. Good job there, TJ's in. Then Yo is Flo, still holding out strong. Did end up losing into the lower bracket, but... still making a pretty good run.
Yeah, so all the players left remaining on the board are in the lower bracket, so we'll keep giving you guys updates throughout the rest of the day. But we're getting close to the end, and to jump into our second last match of the day, we have Korra and Admirable.